Okay. That's better. Okay, by 1950 in America, you know, they start a kind of a study on, but what we don't call rural. At that time, we are focusing more on the people, and we call those people who are living in the rural area peasants. So in the 1950s, is the beginning of peasant studies, starting by Robert Redfield. And as you can see, he still followed Durkheim in a sense that still using the kind of dichotomy, but instead of using the idea of rural urban, he classified rural area as little tradition in contrast to the urban area as a kind of great tradition. The word that he used to describe social world, I mean rural world, as a little tradition, suggesting that he focused more on the culture. I mean the people have some kind of culture that is opposite to the culture in the urban area that is something of the great tradition. So little tradition suggesting that they are more a kind of close society. I mean they are living together as a close society rather than an open society, because in the urban area people are more open in the sense that they are more mobile rather than stay put in one area. Okay, that is in the 50s. But by 1960, all of this had changed, because we have another scholar by the name of Eric Wolff. Eric Wolff wrote his book in 1966 called Peasants. The title is Peasants. This is significant because Eric Wolff has changed his way of looking at the rural world from the perspective of dichotomy into a kind of relationship between the. In fact, he do not focus on the urban, but trying to analyze that the rural world is not a kind of isolated world. Because before that, you know, since the beginning, when you look at rural world from the dichotomy perspective, you tend to look at rural world as isolated kind of social world, in contrast to the urban. But by 1960, Eric Wolff emphasized that rural world is not something isolated, but it has to be seen in relationship to the state. Which means that we cannot understand the rural world without seeing it in relation to the state. So he tried to emphasize that rural social world, in fact, is part of the state. So you cannot have rural society outside the state, because they are rural, not because they are rural by themselves. They are rural because they are, in his term, exploited by the state. You see? So it's a kind of power relation. There will be no rural world without the state who exploiting them, which means that they're trying to take advantage of the rural society. So this is the beginning of the modern study of peasants or rural society. But after that, there will be more debate on how can we better understand this social world. And of course, by 1976, we have a new famous book came out by James Scott, you know, entitled what you call Moral Economy of the Peasants. This is and this is significant because it's the first time that scholar moving their study to Southeast Asia. In fact, there's an earlier study than that, because the rural study, especially study in Thailand, is first introduced after the Second World War. But the American who came here, they also borrow idea from Redfield, you see, to understand Thai rural society at that time. I mean, in 1950, they borrow from Redfield. So, I mean, whatever the American scholar who study about Thai rural world is more or less adopting the idea from Robert Redfield. But they introduce a new concept to describe rural world in the sense that they look at rural world as something more or less a good life, a sense of good life, and describe rural society. I mean, in case of studying rural Thai study, they use the term loosely structured social system. That is the term that they use to describe Thai social world as loosely structured, which means that they contrast it with Japanese society. Japanese society seems to be like a very tightly structured social system in the sense that the people have more obligation to whatever they have trust in, you know. But the Thai society, the Thai rural society is completely different because people have no strong obligation to anything. They cannot work as a group. I mean, they are more individualistic in a sense. So, I mean, during that time, the study of Thai rural society, adopting this Redfield image of good life on the analysis of rural society. But for the case of Thai specifically, they use the term loosely structured social system as a way to describe the kind of rural society, you know, which is rather contradictory in the sense that most people who look at rural society, they seem to think that rural society are more homogeneous and they are more closely connected through kinship, something like that. No, but once they came to study Thai rural society, they describe it something more or less not quite in that direction, in the sense that Thai people are more, I mean, the Thai rural people are more individualistic. You know why? Because when they came to study Thailand, I mean Thai rural society at that time, they choose to study a rural area, a rural village, very close to Bangkok. You see? At that time, Thai rural world is changing very fast. And since they are very close to Bangkok, you know, they are more or less do not stay put in their own village, but they would like to move to Bangkok. And so they have less connection with their own village. And you know why? Now, that particular village that studied by the American scholar from Cornell University, in fact, from the same university that I studied, that is in 1950, called Bang Chan. Now, Bang Chan, that particular village, is part of Bangkok already. I mean, it's almost at the center. It's become a kind of a industrial town now, I mean, at that particular area, as you can see. But in that time, in 1950, it's far away from Bangkok, and you cannot reach there by road. You have to go by boat at that time. So, I mean, the American scholar, they think that, oh, that is already rural enough for them. But in fact, the rural society at the state of change, you know, rapid change, so the people there cannot be characterized as a typical rural area or rural world, you see. So, I mean, the choice of case study is very important. It can tell you something, but if you don't know the context, you will not understand that is that really rural or not, because when you pick up this village that is close to Bangkok that and is in the process of rapidly changing, so I mean it's not, it can, we cannot consider it as a kind of typical rural world, you see. So that is a case of early study on Thai rural village. But I would like to get back to James Scott, because this is another significant step in study of rural world. In the sense that Scott do not only describe, because most of the study in the past, they tend to describe what is rural world. I mean, like they have close relationship, they are more homogeneous. Those are the terms that is we can call descriptive analysis of the social world or of the rural world, you see. But by the time of 1976, James Scott came up with a book entitled The Moral Economy of the Peasants in Southeast Asia. He did a study in Burma and Vietnam, and maybe also part of Indonesia also. So his book cover many countries in Southeast Asia, but he came up with a new thesis and the argument that of course he studied not only about the rural world, but he trying to understand why peasants rebel, because at that time there's a lot of conflict in the rural area. You know, you have Vietnam War. I mean, the rural people usually form together in a kind of movement and trying to liberate themselves from the state or from the whoever, you know, that is dominating them. So there's a lot of rural struggle and many kind of peasant resistance, something like that, protests everywhere. That is in 1970. So Scott trying to understand why the peasants rebel against whoever in power, you see. And his analysis is very interesting in the sense that he used the concept moral economy. You know, that is a term that's first introduced. But in fact, he adopted that concept from British historian by the name of E.P. Thompson. E.P. Thompson used that concept of moral economy to understand the poor in the British industrialization in England. I mean, the industrialization that produced a lot of poor, and he used this term moral economy. And Scott adopted this concept to describe or to analyze peasants. He argued that and his argument is something like different from Marx, you know, Karl Marx. As you probably know, that Karl Marx argued that if you are exploited, you will rebel, something like that. But James Scott came up with the argument that no, I mean, the peasants, even though they are heavily exploited, they still not rebel, you know. But they will rebel when they feel that they have been, like, what you call, in a sense that he described this in the case of like in case of Vietnam, you know. In Vietnam, he used the kind of history that about this kind of patronage relationship, you know, because he think that in the past, before French colonialism, the peasants, they are living under the kind of emperor, and the emperor and the peasants seem to have a kind of patronage relationship, which means that when the peasants, they are producing rice, and they will be taxed by the state. The state will tax them according to the situation. If the peasant can produce good harvest, the emperor may tax a little bit heavily. But if the peasants cannot produce good harvest, then the tax will be less. So the state will tax according to the harvesting situation. Which means that the state is more play the role of patronage, something like to the peasants. But when the French came to rule Vietnam, the situation had changed because the French, they do not understand this kind of patronage relation. So they tend to take to tax the peasants the same fixed rate, you know, whether the harvest is good or not, the tax rate is the same. And that creates some problem in the mind of the peasants. So they feel that because they expect that the state should act as a patron to the peasants, but the French don't understand that, you see. So they feel that the French are too strict, you know, something like that. So they feel that they are, so they have to rebel against the French, you see, because what the French did is contrary to their understanding. So not because the French are exploited, but they do not act in the same way as what they expect from their from their state or from their ruler, I mean the people who rule them, you see. So I mean so this is what James Scott tried to argue, not exploitation but something that do not work in the same way as they expected, create some kind of strong stimulation, you know, that stimulate the peasants to rebel. So this is one kind of argument that James Scott tried to argue for the peasants. That follow from Eric Wolff, that peasants have to be understood in relationship to the state. And Scott add to that kind of argument that the peasants sometimes do not have a good term with the state. You know, they may rebel against the state if the state do not act according to their expectation, something like that. But James Scott argument has been opposed by Samuel Popkin, you know, who wrote a book 2 years after that, and the book entitled Rational Peasants. So most of the time before that, as I mentioned, you know, as a dichotomy, people tend to think that peasants are irrational in the sense that they do not like to follow the rationality of the market, which means that they are resisting to be integrated into the market system, in the sense that they produce as a subsistence economy. You know, they produce more for their own consumption rather than produce for the market. Okay, so when they are doing that, people use the term irrational, in opposite to the rational system in the urban. You know, so that kind of dichotomy is still continue. So by 1978, Samuel Popkin came out with the argument that no, peasants are not irrational as we used to think, but they are more rational in the sense that they are not playing the role in the same way as Scott tried to describe, but in fact they are working hard to protect their own interests, you know, and they are not afraid of the market. I mean, Scott had the idea that the peasants, they look at the market as risk, so they are not they do not like to join the market, do not like to be part of the market, but Samuel Popkin argue in the opposite, that in fact the peasants, they feel that market, instead of looking at market as risk, they think that market can give you some kind of opportunity, you see. So this kind of argument is going on. which means that by 1970, most peasants or rural society or rural community has joined the market system. You see, whether you think that they are afraid or they are seeing market as a chance or not, or opportunity or not, most peasants already at that time has been part of the market economic system, which means that they mostly no longer produce just for their own consumption, but they already take part in the market in some way, or producing for the market. You see, when I first did my dissertation in 1980, I have to read all of this, so I just give you the background that these are the basic reading to understand the so-called rural social world. But by 1980, when I did my dissertation, I also studying about this. I mean, what I study, we can call now the topic seem to be changed a little bit, because my interest during 1980, we shift from the study only how to understand rural social world to something we call agrarian transformation. I mean, the issues is different. So you can see that when we study rural social world, it doesn't mean that we study on the same issues, you know. So the issue before 1980 tend to be mostly understanding social world, understanding the peasants, what is their behavior, how they make decision, something like that. So like when Scott or Popkin talk about peasants, the focus is on how the peasants making decision, you see. But by 1980, the topic is completely different. Okay, we turn to the idea that how the social world are transformed. Anyway, so the topic is more on the agrarian transformation, especially the change from just a kind of isolated social world, you know, and into something like a part of the become part of the market economy, or the now we can call it global economy, because market economy is not limited to the state, like in the case of Eric Wolf, because Eric Wolf tend to look at rural society as part of the state. I mean, remit at the state level, at the national level. But by 1980, we cannot look at the rural society in that way anymore, because once they become part of the global market economy, they are not only faced with the power relation with the state, but also with the with the world economy, you see. So when we study about agrarian transformation at that time, you cannot look at rural society as isolated entity, but we have to look at rural society in relationship to the both the state and the world economy, you see, which make it very very complex kind of relationship. And most of the social science at that time are not well equipped with their own concept in order to understand this kind of transformation. So there's a lot of change in terms of concept and theory that will allow us to understand this kind of agrarian transformation. Usually people just in the beginning, when they start to study about this agrarian transformation, there are many theory at that time, and most of the theory are Marxist oriented, and the most dominant theory we can call like a dependency theory or world system theory or whatever, you know, or mode of production theory. All of these are Marxist oriented kind of theory, which tend to look at, you know, Marxists, they are mainly focused on the structure, which means that from the macro level. And they think that the macro or the structure is very powerful and tend to dominate whoever under that that structure. So the people are more exploited and because the macro tend to be more mobile, more powerful, so they are exploiting the rural people. And because of their exploitation, you know, it makes it difficult for the rural society to change. That's why, because the reason that they are analyzing the rural world, their main idea is that how to understand poverty, or to how to understand what we can call the third world, you see. They do not only try to study about the rural social world, but studying rural social world as part of the third world economy. Why they are not developed, something like that. Because at that time, the so-called mainstream theory is the theory of modernization, or the theory of development, as you probably know, you know. So these two theories are contesting each other in terms of how, or competing each other in terms of how to be well explaining about modernization and development. So you can see that even though we are focusing on the rural social world, but in fact, we cannot understand that by itself. We have to understand that kind of rural social world in the context of modernization and development. Okay? At this point, I don't know whether there will be any kind of question or not, because it will be very complicated from now on, you see. I would like to make sure that you are still following me, because in the beginning, I start out by giving you some background of so-called peasant study, or the study of rural society, you know. But now, by 1980, this is a kind of turning point, you know, whereby the rural study is no longer limited to the rural study. It become part of the study of modernization and development. And you have to bring in so many different kind of theory and concept to help you broaden your understanding of this kind of rapid change, as I call it, agrarian transformation. Agrarian means something related to the land, people of the land, because we look at rural world in the past at people who are more attached to the land, you know. So how the land or the production on the land has changed. So we call it agrarian transformation as a kind of a broader topic or broader issues that will help us understand this kind of social world, a rural social world. Is there any questions now?
Before we going so far in your presentation, for me it's better to me to asking you questions regarding your presentation about the Pisan rebellion against the French colonizations. Mm-hmm. For me, your presentation, when you're saying that the Pisan rebel do not because they are being exploited, mm-hmm. but because the friends do not act according to their expectation.
Yeah, yeah.
For me, a bit doesn't make sense according to the conflict theories.
Uh-huh.
As far as I know, conflict happen in certain communities. There should be a precondition that is like a conflict triangle according to Johann Galtung theory. So conflict triangle explains that the precondition that should be fulfilled of when the conflict happened, that is the attitude and the cognitive and the action. The attitude could be like oppression, domination, exploitation, and the cognitive is like hatred or negative stereotyping. And when these two preconditions culminate within certain community, and then there is a factor of ignition or triggering factor, like the for example, like the government killing some peasant, and this become the ignition or the triggering, which culminate and expose and explode become violence conflict. So that's why I believed I'm a bit thinking that it is a bit doesn't make sense when you said it's only because the patient, the friends do not act according to their expectation, and then the patient become doing some rebellion toward the friends, and that's why. Could you explain more about this thing? Thank you.
Yes, because this is the argument by James Scott, and in fact, he intentionally would like to argue with those people that you mentioned. You see. Because those people that you mentioned, they are looking at this kind of rebellion form we can call using outsider point of view. Okay? Using the perspective of the academic and try to analyze the people. So James Scott, in fact, he follow what we can call phenomenological perspective, which means that he tried to understand why peasant rebel from the insider point of view, which means that from the point of view of the peasant themselves, how they think that they rebel. You see? So he think that, so he used this kind of case in Vietnam to support, to justify his argument, you know, that the peasants, the Vietnamese peasants, they are thinking in that way. Of course, this argument may not be the same as others, you see, because he tried to argue that you cannot look at peasant rebellion only from the outsider point of view, but you have to look from the also insider point of view also. Of course, this is one kind of argument. It doesn't mean that it's the only argument, because there are many other kind of argument, you see, about this kind of rebellion. So we still have to discuss and debate on all of this. So what James Scott argued may be specific or may be unique. that we have to explain. Maybe it cannot be generalized. It depends on how we will adopt this kind of perspective in our analysis. Because in this kind of study, we cannot only rely on one kind of argument or one kind of analysis. You see, because there are many type of peasant society in the world, you know. In some situation, they may rebel according to this kind of argument. But this is James Scott's argument. You can read from his book. It's very famous. When the book came out in 1976, it just like blow up the world. Why? Because we mostly adopting Marxist perspective or conflict theory perspective in analysis of the peasants. You see, but most of that, as I say, Marxist oriented, they are looking from structural point of view, looking from the outside point of view, power relations, you know. But Scott tried to dig into the people perspective, how they think that they rebel, not that what is the kind of power that push them to rebel. They are not talking about the pressure, external pressure. They are talking about the internal understanding, you see. So, of course, these two perspectives should be more discussed and debate. I do not claim that you have to follow Scott all the time. In fact, as I mentioned before, Samuel Popkin already opposing Scott. He said that he argued against Scott in the sense that Scott claimed that patronage relationship is very good. As I mentioned before, you know, between the emperor and the peasant. In fact, Samuel Popkin already argued that no, in fact, patronage relationship is more exploited than the French, you know. So That's why they overthrow the emperor before that, you see. So I mean, this is kind of a debate that was going on for a long time already, but not yet settled. Many people still follow Scott, but many people turn to Popkin as a rational person. Yeah. So this kind of debate is continued. So that's why when we try to understand rural social world, we have to be equipped with a lot of perspective, different perspective. Maybe some of them are contradictory to each others, but that is what academic world should rely on, not stick to any one particular theory. You know, we have to be free to borrow any ideas that is more or less relevant to whatever situation or the case study that we are trying to focus on. Okay? Yeah. Any more questions? So it's good, you know, to have some debate so that I can clarify, because otherwise I try to be more brief, because we have a lot of things to say, but in such a short period of time, I cannot cover everything. Okay? Yes?
Yeah. Thank you very much. So one thing that I want to note about the explanation that you say that a Thai rural society is more individual, mm-hmm. but that I have to know before, but if you live in a rural area, of course you will live together with the others, you know, mm-hmm. and then you say also connected by kinship, etc., but this is vice versa with the individual. So maybe you explain more about that, because if I walk around this Chiang Mai 2 years ago and then today and then also in Bangkok, I saw a lot of people of Thai, so you know, they has a good friendship and then smile, etc. Yeah, yeah. That I, you know, and then I have a close friend also in southern Thailand, so they helpful and then
yeah.
But today I heard that you said it more individual, so because I don't understand about that. Could you?
Yeah. Okay, it's good, because this is another debate. You see, because even in Thai study, we have this debate again between the so-called loosely structured school of thought that I mentioned, that they're trying to describe. They describe and not analyze. They describe that Thai rural people are more individualistic, you know, based on their concept of loosely structured social system. That is introduced into Thai study from 1950. But by 1970-something, I forgot, maybe 76 or so, Jack Potter, you know, another scholar from Berkeley, UC California at Berkeley, he came here to do his research. But not in Bangkok. He studied here in Chiang Mai. In fact, not very far from Chiang Mai city here, about 10 or so kilometers, you know, the so-called Kudang, you know, Sarapi district, not very far from here. And he entitled his book, what you call, Thai Peasant Social Structure. In fact, he argued against the loosely structure argument in the sense that he argued that the peasants here in Chiang Mai are more tightly structured. You can see there's a debate. Why? Because they think that in Chiang Mai or in the north, they are well organized into, especially we use the example of so-called indigenous or local irrigation organization. Because as you can see, in this area of the north, the land is very small. I mean, the peasants' the size of farm holding is very small in comparison to the people, the farmer in Bangkok. Bangkok is a kind of flat plain, you see. So their farm is very large, maybe like, let's say, maybe like a 5 or 6 acre. But in Chiang Mai, it's less than an acre. Oh, or maybe about an acre or something like that. So the holding is very small, so they have to manage their farm very efficiently. And to do that, they need irrigation. So irrigation system is very important for the people here. That's why they stick together to organize themselves into the irrigation. Which means that whenever you describe about peasants, you cannot generalize. You have to put them in context. This is what I try to say. So the context of this of the central plain of I mean in Thailand, the central plain, you know, the, in Bangkok area, is completely different from in Chiang Mai area. Chiang Mai area, we are mountainous area, and the farm is very small. So, you know, this is the context that make the life of the peasants a little bit different. So the people here are more tightly structured, we can say that. Okay, so we have both in Thailand. We do not only have really tightly structured. And as I mentioned before, the rural society in the central plain or near Bangkok, they are on the move. They are in the process of rapid change, see? So the people are less attached to each other. But here, of course, that is in the 70s. But now, maybe a little bit different already, you know. In the 70s, you know, in Chiang Mai, they are still tightly structured. I mean, they are closely together. They are more organized according to their kin group, irrigation organization, something like that, you know. In fact, Jack Potter found out that we have about, in the north, we have at least 10 or 11 kind of organization. But the rural structure people, they say that in Bangkok, no structure, no organization, people cannot work together. It's a completely different thing. So this is the kind of debate. So when we study, we cannot just focus on any one kind of argument. We have to learn about the debate. And most of the debate are situated in a different kind of context. Okay? Can you understand that? Okay, fine, yeah. So this is something that we have to bear in mind. We cannot just Thai peasant social structure. Thai peasant social structure. Yeah, that is the title of his book in 1976. Huh? Seven or something like that. Yeah. Huh? 1977. Yeah. So you can see that not only the time different, but the context different. That make the argument different. So we cannot look at rural social world form a kind of one mono point of view. So we have, yeah, it's good that we have two big argument, you know, in terms of the peasant rebellion and also the kind of social structure of the Thai peasants. So you can see that we are talking about peasants in Southeast Asia, you know, and as you can see, when we talk about Vietnamese peasants, Thai peasants, or what else peasants, you know, they are not all the same or not that, they don't share the same kind of heuristic because they live in a different kind of context or socio-political system. Okay, now we have to come back to our agrarian transformation. So from 1980, 90, you know, the topic is, this topic of agrarian transformation is very popular among scholars. But I already start out with the idea that agrarian transformation first study using Marxist-oriented theory. You know, there are many theories, as I mentioned, you know. Mostly dominated by dependency theory. Okay, that kind of theory looking, they tend to look at rural social world from the structure or macro perspective. And they think that peasants are more or less passive. You know, so now again, you see, which means that they tend to be passive, which means that they are under domination of the political and economic structure. Okay, so whatever change in the rural area, it changed because of the outside influence. I mean, the outside structure, outside economy, outside whatever, you know, put a lot of pressure on the peasant to change. And if the so-called market economy and the state force the peasant to change, which means that they tend to integrate the peasants into the so-called external market, you know, first by forcing them to produce to the market. After that, you know, tend to integrate them into the so-called urban economy by integrate them into the, by change them into the so-called labor, you know, and work and push them into become bankrupt or something like that, you know, no longer able to stay in the rural area to produce, because the more you are engaged in the market, you know, the more you be losing, because you cannot get enough income from that kind of market integration. And there are many mechanisms, you know, these people will be explained by, especially like a taxation mechanism that put the rural people into the advantage, disadvantage. Especially in Thailand, we talk about so-called rice premium, a kind of tax. Because Thai export a lot of rice, so they tax the rice export, we call premium tax. That will put the pressure on the price of rice. That is one way of explaining, you know, that how the macro structure put a lot of pressure on the rural economy. The other kind of explanation, I mean, using this kind of Marxist-oriented explanation, they will say that, the market don't like to give advantage to the rural people because they would like to keep the rural people poor and the price of rice low. Because if the price of rice is low, that will give some advantage to the industrialization. Because in industrialization, you have to pay a lot of wage to the labor. If the wage of the labor is low, and mostly the labor will use most of their wage to pay for rice. So if the price of rice is high, you cannot pay the low wage for the industry, you see. So this is a kind of, I just give you the example, how they explain the reason why they keep the rural people poor and the price of rice low, you know. Not because the people themselves, as you can see, so in this way, the explanation trying to paint the picture is that the rural people are passive, you see, which is something a little bit different from James Scott, that the people are also rebel, the peasants, you see. So there are many kind of argument that's going on in the 1980s. So the agrarian transformation has been transformed because of the external force, especially the political and economic force from outside, especially from the market. So this is another kind of argument. So when I did my just to give you some idea about what I work on, you see, because I did a research, especially for my dissertation on this particular topic. So what I try to argue at that time is that, no, the peasants are not passive. In fact, they are more engaged in some kind of negotiation with the market, you know. So in the agrarian transformation, the transformation is not because is not only rely on the external force, but the agrarian transformation is transformed because of the engagement by both sides, by the external power and the peasants. So the peasants also enter into the negotiation in the sense that they try to negotiate for the best they can in terms of gaining more from the market. So the agrarian formation is not only from the external force, but through this kind of engagement and negotiation, you know, the peasants' community are changed. So the change is not from the outside force alone, but also from the negotiation from the local people, because they also benefit. It doesn't mean that they do not benefit, you see. So we can see that by 1980s, we tried to combine the argument from James Scott and Popkin, you know, and look at the peasants as more active actor, enter into this kind of by entering into this kind of negotiation. Of course, my analysis at that time, I used the production relations in the farming, especially in terms of, at that time we talk about land tenure, land lease, land rent, and also what you can call labor employment as the two kind of relationship in order to explain this kind of negotiation. Because I found out in my study that at that particular time, there are more complex land rent, you know, and more complex labor employment in the farming. Why? Because the peasants are also negotiate for the higher wage. What they do is that if you do not give me a higher wage in farming, I will go out to work in the city, you see. So working in the city or moving out or moving into, at that time we call non-farm employment. So we have on-farm employment, so the term that we are using at that time, on-farm employment and non-farm employment, you see. So when we have both kind of employment occur at the same time, the peasants have choice. So they can choose to stay on in the farming system or they can move out to work in the city. And at that time, you know, those who still stay in the farming, they have to raise the wage, you know, in order to attract people to stay on in the farm. Okay? And by now you can see, you know, the wage in the farming system or in the farming society now is very high, you know. At that time, I found out that it's the beginning of mechanization. You know, they have to start introducing more, what you can call tractor, whatever, you know, into, at that time we don't have this, now we have combined harvester. Because of the rise of the wage in the farming system, you see. But at that time, we don't have yet combined harvester, which means that they only have a kind of minimum kind of mechanization, mostly a kind of tiller, tractor tiller, you know, to plow the land. Yeah. So that is the indication that the higher wage is a result of negotiation. It's not because the people like to give higher wage. Nobody like to give high wage, right? Yeah. So they are forced to give higher wage. So that is in opposition or opposite to the earlier argument that whatever change is come from external force, okay? But what I try to argue is that change is not only come from external force, but through negotiation. That's why you have to give higher wage to the peasants, because they are engaged in this negotiation since they have more choice, you see? So this is maybe one of the example, you know, because there are many examples, but just to give you the idea that the agrarian transformation is not transformed by itself or not because of the external force, but it's through this kind of complex negotiation by different actors who are involved in the production, in the farming, you know. Okay, so just take a break here, so that maybe there will be some kind of question that I can help elaborate more. Is there any questions on this point? Because it's very important, since you can see that you cannot follow any one perspective, like I said before, you know, in your analysis of the rural social world, you need a lot of perspective to help you. And my argument is that first, the agrarian transformation cannot occur by itself automatically, you know, and cannot be only forced from the outside, but also from the rural engagement in this process too. So there are three kind of argument, you know, that explaining or analyzing this process of agrarian change. Yes?
It seems to me like there are big landowners who own large tracts of land, and then they have workers that are given wages. Or is it mostly all smallholders, like farmers who own their land, who are demanding higher prices for their goods?
Yeah, you talk about Thailand, and it's very difficult because, like I mentioned before, in the north here, the holding is very small, so you have a small holder mostly, most of them. The biggest may be about like a 5 or 6 acre only. You know, I mean the biggest in here, in the north. But in the central plain, then completely different. In the central plain, you know, it's mostly we can call large holder, but some of them are not landowner. They have to rent land, but they don't rent 5 or 6 acres. They probably rent 50 acres, something like that.
And they're renting it from the government or some
people?
No,
they rent it from the large landowner in Bangkok, you see. So we have, you know, in Thailand, we used to have royal family, not used, we still have, but many people in the royal family, they own a large land in the central plain because when we start exporting rice, long time ago, to more than 100 years ago, you know, at that time, we don't have that many rice land or farmland. So they have to start developing more farmland. And those people who can invest in open up new farmland are the people who still in power at that time, you see. So they use many kind of in fact, we import, at that time we can say we import a lot of Chinese, you know, from China, because in that time they're still very poor. And we need labor, but usually people in Thailand don't like to work. I mean, they don't like to work for others. They only work for their own farm, so they don't work. That's why we have to import Chinese from China to use as a labor to dig a canal. And we dig a lot of, so many. As you can go in Bangkok, in the past, we are known as Venice of the East, something like that, you know, because we have a lot of canal. So they are digging at that time, you know, and they are dug mainly by Chinese labor. You can see, that's why we have a lot of Chinese in Thailand, you know. They are originally from that time. So they are import a lot of labor, digging canal and also building railway. The railway from Bangkok to Chiang Mai is also built by the Chinese, you see. So you can see that this is what happening. So at that time, those people who can own land are from the royal family or whatever, who are the aristocrat. And they still own those land and they don't do the farming. So they rent out their land that is in the central plain. In the north here, some of the, we also have another royal family here because Chiang Mai is a kind of independent state at that time, independent kingdom. So they have their own royal family. But the royal family is very small in comparison with those in Bangkok. So they own not that much land. They own some land, but not that much. Most of the farmland are small holder, as I said. So this is a different. That's why we have more problem of land rent in Bangkok than here. But here we also have a lot of land, but mainly they are renting land from their own relative, not from the large landowner. But still, in 1970 something, we have a lot of conflict here in the north because the peasants are also rebelled against this kind of land rent they would like to negotiate for a lower rent, because the rent we can call sharecropping. At that time, like when you produce after the harvest, they divided the harvest into two parts, one for the landowner, one from the tenant, or something like that. So if we call sharecropping, half and half sharecropping, something like that. So they would like to lower that to one third share, you know, giving the landowner only one third, not the half and half, something like that. So we have this also problem also, but not that not as intensive as in the central plain, you know. Okay, so that is a situation of land holding situation in Thailand. But in the northeast, completely different again. So we cannot just generalize everything in Thailand in the same way. In the northeast, you even have, it's a small holder, but small holder have a large farm because the farm is not productive. You see, I mean, the yield is very low in the northeast because they are very dry and most of the farm is rain fed, you know. Here in the Chiang Mai area, you know, even the farm is very small, but we produce triple crop, three times a year, you see, with well irrigated area, you see. So, I mean, we have to differentiate between what area we are talking about. We cannot generalize the peasants' world in Thailand as all the same, because they have completely different kind of economic structure and this kind of land owning system. Okay, any other questions? Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
I got a point in your presentations. You just say that rural people are made to be poor, right? You say that rural people.
Yeah.
Are made to be poor,
yeah.
Right? Sure. Okay. My question is, can you explain the reason? Because so yesterday we go around the crafts village, and then the other team go to Karen village and other nice place. Actually, the rural people is not poor. They are rich. They are rich about natural resources, like in craft village. They are rich about skill to how to carve. The carving over there is very 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 good. And then the same in I got information from my friends that in Karen village they are rich about natural resources, and then some of the people there have luxury cars. So it's different. You explain at the moment.
Yeah.
In this forum. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. You have to put it in the time frame. You see. What I'm talking about, that the macro structure try to keep the rural people poor, that is during the 1960, 70, early 80, something like that, during that time period. Yeah, I mean before 80, yeah, that we have the so-called premium tax. Because at that time is the early stage of industrialization in Thailand, yeah, early stage. So the Thai government have the policy that to keep the food price low, okay? So I mean, most farmers have to produce food, right? When you keep their price low, it means that they become poor, yeah? Why they would like to keep the food price low? Because they don't like to put, they like to give a higher wage for the industrial worker, yeah? You can see that the two worlds are interrelated. You cannot just say that we're talking about the rural area by themselves. You know, you have to see how they are related, and the government policy is very important at that time. And that the Thai government always have this policy all along. I mean, before 1980. Keep the food price low. And how to keep the food price low? You put the tax on top, you know? So, I mean, the exporter cannot get much benefit from their export, right? So they push the price down to the farmer, you see? So they cannot buy a high price from the farmer, right? Because they will get the high tax from the government when they try to export, right? Yeah. So that is the situation before 1980. But when you are talking about situation now, the Thai market is more open. In fact, we opened all along, but before 80, they put a lot of tax, you know, that is make a lot of problem. But now I think we already eradicate most of those kind of tax, because especially after 1990, we all open up more economy. I mean, open up Thai more, open up Thai economy more to the global market. In fact, now we can say we have almost free market, you see, in the sense that they open up not only the tax, but also the currency exchange, everything. You can see that's completely free, everything, liberated from any kind of burden, tax burden, whatever, you know. So with that kind of free market, it allow people, I mean the rural people, with more choice, you know, to enter into the market. Some of them continue producing crops for the market, but many of them now earn more money from non-farm product, like you said, right? Handicraft or whatever. Yeah. So I mean, now they have more choice of income, you know, from different sources. So this gives them some better access to higher income in some way. But still, we cannot have only the rosy pictures of what happening here, you know, because only certain sector, only certain farming sector that benefit. But some of the farming sector, as you might not know, that in Thailand, you know, we have at least 10 million people living in the so-called state forest. Okay, you have some more question?
Thank you very much for the presentation when you
are you?
Surrounded with very good theories about rural transition, right? But I would like to ask you one question. That's what do you think about the most important determinants of the agrarian transition of Thailand for Thailand for Patakuna? Do you think that it is when Thailand allow the private owners of land, of it is a development of irrigation infrastructure, of that helped that does improve the mass transportation of Thai agriculture? So what do you think about the most important factors as determinants this process?
In the beginning, the Thai government concentrate on building infrastructure like roads, like you said, you know, that is in the 60s. Yeah, they, as you can see, now we have better road, you know. So they spend a lot of money on building infrastructure. Yeah, that helps a lot for the like a kind of exporting crops, you know, for export, because Thai economy always rely on so-called export-oriented kind of economy, which means that we trying to stimulate economy through this kind of export. As you can see now, more than 70% of the earning, you know, came from export in Thailand at the moment. So we rely so much on export. So whenever we have problem with export, then the entire economy will collapse, because we rely too much, 70%, you see. And the rest is from tourism, you see. In fact, the rural economy that we are talking about now is only make 10% earning for the total GDP only, you see. Even though we are exporting a lot of agricultural product, you know, but from the farm system, from the farm sector, is only 10% contribution to the Thai economy. Of course, we have still 60% of population in the farming sector, but they contribute 10% of the Thai economy. So we have a lot of problem in that sense, because we keep too much people that contribute not very much to the economy, which means that we still do not have a kind of productive use of our labor. Yeah. And the labor cost is now very high, so it's very difficult to really, we need a lot of change in order to move up from this level. Because if we rely on a kind of cheap labor policy, then we have to bring in a lot of labor from outside. Yeah. So cheap labor policy cannot maintain anymore if we would like to move up. Yeah, but in the past, you know, so we have a lot of many policy like infrastructure building, cheap labor policy, lower food price, something like that. All of these policies are not are not well situated to the present situation anymore. Yeah. That's why we are now got stuck in what we can call middle income country trap. Yeah. Because we stuck with the old policy that never relevant to the new situation. Yeah.
Thank you for your presentation, and I'm very glad that I can deepen my understanding of rural situation in Thailand. But I want to know more about urban areas, because it is very difficult to see what really rural area is unless we compare rural and urban. So and see both similarity and difference. So my question is that, first, I want to know when the study of urban area in Thailand started, and the second question is, can you give me some examples of study of urban area in Thailand have been done? Thank you.
Okay, thank you for the question. But in fact, I'm not very good at urban study. But my argument will be that we cannot understand from studying rural society, because at the moment, you know, the two worlds is no longer separated, yeah, because it's closely connected. But the early study of the urban area in Bangkok is start with the study of the slum, okay? Because that is where the rural people move into the urban area. And when they move into the urban area, they have to, end up in the urban area, in the slum area, not the well-developed urban area, you know? So that is, which means that the first study about rural urban is on the migration, rural migration, yeah? So the first movement is going into the urban area for work. You know, because I supervise one PhD student from Australia, and she later on wrote a PhD thesis, they say entitled Road to the City. That is in 1990. She studied about how the rural people in Chiang Mai area move into Chiang Mai, because the one of the development of the urban area is about the increase of the expansion of the service sector. That is not only the industry like Chiang Mai, you know, service sector, because Chiang Mai is a tourist destination. So we all have hotels. You can see now we have more shopping center than we can shop, you know, so many on one street you have You can see, you go out, you know, on one street, I don't know, four or five shopping center, department store, whatever. And where else they can get all their employment from, you know, all the rural people. So you can see that at that time, we can call shuttle migration, which means that they only shuttle in and out, you know, every day, you know, moving out. So this thesis describes rural village as a kind of village dormitory. So the village becomes just a dormitory, you know, no longer a village because they don't have a village life anymore. Most of the time they spend in the urban area, you know, selling things or whatever, doing working in the hotel or any kind of services, you know. So they don't have any more social life in their village anymore. So their village becomes just a dormitory. Get back, put to sleep, you know, that's all. No more social life, you see. This is what's happening. Yeah. So you can see that the rural and urban is no longer completely separate, but together in some way. Yeah? So I mean, the rural is just for sleeping, but the urban is more for earning. Yeah, something like that. Where is your social life? And most of the time, you stay in the urban area because in Chiang Mai we have a local dialect. Yeah, so most of the time you have to speak Central Thai here in the urban area. When you go back home, now you don't like to speak any more local dialect because you get used to it. So it become a lot of problem. Yeah, in this sense, you can see that the people have to, what you call, encounter this kind of transformation. Yeah, recently. Yeah, so this is one way of understanding rural social world, not as a kind of isolation or isolated entity, but they involve in. And if you look at what happening now that I mentioned in my article that you can read by yourself, you know, I use the term transforming the agrarian transformation, which means that now it's not only transformation, but the transformation itself transforming, you know, because of the closely connected world between the outside and the rural world, you know, is closely connected. So when you go to the rural area and you see they are farming, yeah, they are working on the land, we don't know whether they are farmer or they are employer. You see, because it's difficult. Because most of the farmer now, they are working as a kind of a subcontractor, which means that they're working as a subcontracting worker from the big company. Like you go out, you know, whatever you are, like you see, like especially now in the production of corn, you know, because Thai have changed the policy. Now we change the food into energy, yeah? Like we producing corn, not for food anymore. Producing corn to produce alcohol to put in the gasoline. Yeah, in Thailand we no longer have pure gasoline anymore. We have gasohol. Yeah, the sohol came from this corn production. You see, so that's why corn production is everywhere now. And those who are producing corn, they are not their own farmer. They become just a subcontractor. They are subcontracting to produce corn for so-called agribusiness, agro industry. So now we cannot just talk about agriculture and industry because the two go together. That's why we call agro industry, because they are using corn to produce alcohol. You see? Okay, so they have a big factory. And big factory need a lot of raw material. Huh? You cannot just stop your industry. You see, once you start, you cannot stop. If you stop, you will lose. You see, so they keep producing 24 hours a day. So they need raw material, a good flow of raw material to come in into their factory. You see, so they need a large production of corn. And to do that, they cannot just allow you to be a kind of a freeholder to produce by themselves, because you know the farmer, they are not disciplined enough, you know, to produce, they produce as they like. You know? So now we develop a new kind of subcontracting system in order to make sure that the farmer produce according to the industrial discipline. Okay? So now you can see that even though you produce on the farm, but your production system is industry. So you cannot call it agriculture anymore. So in the rural area, even though they're still farming, but you cannot call them agriculture anymore because it become, what do you call, industrial agriculture, agro-industry, something like that, see? So it become very confused now. If you ask me about whether the rural area now they are producing agriculture, well, they produce agriculture, you see it, you know, on the manifestation. But in fact, the social relation or the economic relation behind that production, it become industrial relations, no longer purely agriculture. So now it become very confused. So you cannot just separate rural world from the urban anymore because the two are closely connected in terms of production system. Yeah. So the mixtures of the two become part of the so-called rural world that we are studying at the moment. Yeah. So no one in the rural area now can claim that they are themselves farmer. In fact, now we have less than 10% farmer. I mean, completely farmer. You cannot stay on farm as a farmer anymore at the moment. Yeah. If you are on farm, most of them rely on non-farm income. Yeah. So now non-farm income become more majority of their income, even though you are on the farm. Yeah? But your income, in fact, come from non-farm income, not the farm income anymore. Yeah. You see. So this is a kind of a rural social world as we can see it at the moment. Okay, so this is the kind of pictures that we should understand at the moment as the agrarian transformation become more rapidly transformed. Yeah. Because even today, we are now become part of the globalization system, you know, become part of globalization. So the rural economy have been driven more by the so-called, we call neoliberal ideology, which means that they try to push more free market to drive the rural economy. Yeah. And even though, as I mentioned before, that the rural people are able to negotiate, but now the negotiation become less and less become less and less, you know, because they are no longer able to negotiate because of the force of the market. So now when we study rural social world, we have to look from the process of globalization and localization. So in between is that how possible that the local people can negotiate with the global market. That is what happening now more and more in the rural area. But as I mentioned before, their ability to negotiate become less and less now. Yeah. Because they have to rely more and more, as I say, you know. If you would like to produce something on the farm now, you no longer have labor. All your children move to the city, you see. And most of the farmers on farm are older people. Yeah. So what can they do? Either they have to rent some machine or they have to hire a kind of transnational labor, yeah, migrant worker from neighboring country, yeah, which means that the so-called whatever surplus you can gain from your production is very small. The margin of profit is very, very small, yeah, on the farming system. That's why the farming sector can contribute only 10% of the Thai economy, yeah, because everything on farm cannot produce high enough profit margin anymore. Yeah. Whatever profit that you can earn is all taking away by the so-called subcontracting system. Yeah. So now I consider farmer only as a worker. So they are industrial worker working on the farm. So they are no longer farmer. So the farmer become industrial worker in reality. Yeah. So you may see them as a farmer, you know. But in fact, they are industrial worker working on the farm. Yeah. So I like to end with that. Yeah. Just to give you some pictures of what have been changing in the rural social world. But anyway, do we still have time for some more questions? Yeah, okay, so we still have some more questions just to help you gain better understanding of what I have said before. Yeah, okay. Yeah, there's some questions.
Thank you. So this is the second question.
Yeah.
I'm curious about connections, or maybe I call it this, I want to talk about the impact between tourism and then what and Thai rural society. Just as you know that we're talking about the tourism, of course it's very important today to Thai people. And then furthermore, talking about the tourism as well, the tourism industry involves a lot of things, a few sectors, I mean, such as economy, of course, and then social, culture, etc. So maybe you can give me, describe, is there the negative impact of the, tourism in Thailand with the Thai rural society? Because I want to compare with Indonesia. Some of the places in Indonesia are, of course, influenced by the tourism, I mean, influenced by life, daily life, I mean, of the society, because they bring some, you know, particular in Islam society in Indonesia as well. So some of the people in the Islam area protected their cultural life with those tourists to come because, maybe expat in Bali, of course, talking about maybe about in Thailand particular. So I mean some of the area far from Bangkok, I mean, yeah, like in Chiang Mai or maybe mm-hmm. the northeast or some places.
Yeah, of course, we cannot paint a rosy pictures of what we can earn from this tourism business, you know, tourism industry. Yeah, because there are many issues, but the first that come to mind to most people is the kind of we can call income distribution. Yeah, you can see that we have big hotel, but it doesn't mean that the poor people or the rural people will benefit in the same way. Yeah, they may only get less than. I'm not sure. I did not do this kind of research, but I think they get only a few percentage from whatever that make some earning in the tourist industry. So the earning distribution or the income distribution is not that good. Only benefit the tour operator or the hotel or those service sector more than the rural people. Yeah, that is one way to see it. But most of these, I think, depend on participation, because now, you know, the rural people also negotiate for more participation in the organization and management of tourism. And we have many projects in Thailand on the so-called community-based tourism, you know, CBT. Yeah. Yeah. So that people will gain more, you know, instead of giving everything to the big operator. So how, and you know, I did some small research and found out that now, because of better communication, the people can now participate more. Now they use all of this new communication technology, IT, you know. Oh, they can publicize their own, like now we have homestay or whatever, you know. They can publicize on the web, yeah, and they can get direct communication with their client or something like that. So they don't have to go through the operator, the tourist operator, to get their customers, something like that. So this is one of the benefit that they can make. But of course, in terms of culture, that also depends on participation. If you allow, because now the government try to promote tourism quite a lot. So now we can call commercialization of culture. Yeah? They try to commercialize all kind of culture for the benefit of tourism. So like in Thailand, yeah, the famous for, I mean not Thailand, I mean Chiang Mai, we are famous for whatever, Loi Ka Thong, you know, some of the festival, yeah? We have a lot of festival. So the festival, once become more commercialized, is no longer culture. It's become commercial culture. Whatever commercial, you know, is no longer related to your heart, to feeling, to anymore. It's only for money. So that is a tendency that's going on. But it doesn't mean that it will go that way or in all cases, you know. So the people, rural people in some area, they're trying to participate more. I mean, to engage more in their participation of tourist management in some area. Now you can, if you visit, there will be some kind of we call homestay village or whatever, you know, I mean this kind of community-based tourism. So they're trying to play more role in the tourist management rather than allow someone else. But of course, this is just a beginning, you know, in some area that I found. But in most of the cases, you know, tourism become what we call mass tourism. Whenever we have mass tourism, that we have a strong impact on the rural community, because mass tourism don't care, and the tourists, they don't care either, because they came only for a few days, they don't know what's happening, you know. So we would like to develop not mass tourism, but more, what you can call, niche market or more specific kind of tourists, you know, who came for certain purposes, you know, some kind of eco-tourism, whatever tourism, you know. Now we can see that there are many kind of tourist management, tourist kind of management that oriented towards specific type of tourists. All of this may help a little bit, but I'm not so sure, you know. We cannot just too optimistic about all of this. Yeah, because whenever you rely on the commercial management of anything, you know, those probably cannot maintain the kind of culture or whatever that we would like to conserve or maintain. Yeah, yeah. So it's this kind of thing is going on. It's a kind of war of talk, you know. It's the kind of that you have to risk something, you know, gain something, whatever, you know. Okay, that is what I can observe at the moment, because it's not my specialized area of research, so I cannot say that.
Okay, thanks. As you mentioned earlier, the James Scott, so also he later was dealt with the kinds of everyday forms of resistance, specifically in Malaysia community. So in that context, I wonder that, is there any kinds of everyday forms of resistance or the other forms of resistance has been done by the subcontractor Thai farmer against the big the corporate?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, most of the resistance now more or less is related to the context of resource management. Because the more developed, in fact, development is not because of, we cannot call productive development at the moment, or not creative development anyway. Because development still rely on exploitation of resources, you see, especially now mining, you know, dam building, whatever, you know, all of these become part of the competition for resources. Yeah, and usually the poor, they rely more on resources, but now the commercial sector or the capitalist or the industry trying to gain more access to those the same resources, so it become a kind of intensive competition for the same resources, yeah? Starting from forest, that is my area. So forest is no longer for agriculture now. It's for tourism also, you see? That's why the two sectors are competing, yeah? The same as river. Now river is no longer for fishing. Yeah, it's for damming also. Yeah, so they produce many things, yeah, from the dam, yeah. And we still have a lot of problem in that area, yeah. But less, now more problem in our neighboring countries, yeah. But Thailand now, no new dam can be built easily. I can say that, yeah. Because we have a lot of protests from the peasant movement, whatever, you know. We have, we call Assembly of the Poor, who still very active, you know, in terms of resisting, opposing, yeah, the building of the dam, yeah. Because they are faced, they are still live in the area where they rely more on fishing. And when you dam the river, especially at the mouth of the river, and most of the river here in Thailand, you know, or in Southeast Asia, or in the Mekong region, you know, rely more on the Mekong River, you see. And if the Mekong cannot go into your river, you are dead. You no longer have fish. Because fish is only breed well in the large river, you see. Especially like Cambodia, you know, most of the poor rely on the Tonle Sap. And even in Vietnam, even though now they have fish culture or fish aquaculture, but still, you know, without good breeding source, breeding area, you know, they cannot have enough food to eat. So I mean, this is why people still resisting in their everyday life, as you can see. Yeah, all of this is in the context of competition for resources, and in the mining also. Now mining become one of the area of peasant resistance now. Yeah, in Thailand. Yeah, in many places, because we now have gold mining, coal mining, whatever mining, you know, or in many places, in many area, especially in the north, we also have coal mining, still a lot of problem. And in the northeast now, gold mining, yeah. I don't know, in the central plain, still gold mining in one of the central plain. In the south, it's not about mining, but it's about, we have to, because we need energy. And now we rely more or less most of the energy, not only from hydropower, but also mostly from the gas power from the Gulf of Thailand and also from the oil. But now we try to shift to coal power to generate electricity, and we have to import from Indonesia or from Australia. And importing coal is not just importing coal, but it's produce a lot of problem for the people in the south who rely on coastal fishing, you see. So, I mean, people in the, we have a long coast, you know, and the coastal fishing is one of the area where you have a lot of peasants resistant, yeah, against this kind of importing coal. Because when you have to import, you have to build a large harbor, and the large harbor is not good for fishing ecology, you see. Yeah, so all of these, you know, so you can see that when we talk about rural area, you know, there are many kind of rural area. We are in the north concerned more with the mountain, river, you know, but the people in the south, you know, they are concerned more with that sea, with their coastal resources. So anyway, my point is that more and more competition for the same resources from different sector, you know, the commercial sector, industrial sector, the rural sector, now they are competing for the same resources in different way. Yeah. And this kind of competition for resources become very intensive, and this is will be one of the area whereby one of the area that can contribute more to the agrarian transformation, in the sense that we have to develop many kind of mechanism, you know, in order to resolve all of this conflict, yeah, in terms of like tax. We have to change our tax system, tax structure, whatever, and also changing our law on resources. Because like now, you know, in Thailand, we don't have a land law. Yeah, I mean land tax, not land law, land tax. We have land law, but not land tax. Yeah, so tax is really low. That's why people can keep accumulating their land, you know. And that kind of problem in land distribution will intensify that conflict for resources, you know. And if we allow land to accumulate without using it, it will be lower our productive forces in Thailand, you know, because land is very important for a country like Thailand. If the land allowed to be accumulated without putting it into use, it will lower our productive capacity. Yeah. And that is not good for the economy in general, and of course not good for the poor. Yeah. Okay. Any other last question? No more. No more time. Yeah. Okay. I hope that you enjoy some of my point, because I cannot cover all the thing, but at least I make my point in some of the area that I hope that it interested you. Okay. Thank you.
We did enjoy it. We did enjoy it very much. Thank you, Professor Anand, for an insightful talk, giving us more clearer, complex perspective and arguments on social ruler world. And of course, thank you for all the participants' question. And of course, Ajahn Soi, Professor Soimat, for a great helping hand.
Yes.
So
thank you,
Ajahn Soimat, for the great help. Next program will be a group discussion. It will be divided into three topics by three professors. So first topic would be on agrarian transformation in this room by Professor Dr. Jamari Chiang Tong. She's the head of the Department of Social Anthropology, and her focus would be on agrarian studies, peasant society in northern Thailand and Laos border. Second room will be on Sirinakorn room by Professor Chu Sak Wittiapak on resource conflict in rural Thai society. And his expertise is on forestry conservation, community forestry, and agrarian transformation. Third room will be Kirima room by your lunch, right, in front of your lunch, by Ajahn Soimat Rungmani on the topic of rural-urban migration. Her focus is on challenges of rural communities to sustain natural resources and livelihood. So now please enjoy your break, coffee break, and refreshment is outside. And then after lunch, you come back here in this room to see the very creative and unconventional film documentary, I would say, Boundary, or in Thai, Fa Tam Phan Din Sung. And the director of the film will also be with us today too, Kun Nonthawat Nam Benjapon. So please enjoy your break and continue the next program. Thank you.
So what is the agrarian question? It is classically concerns agriculture, capitalist accumulation, and the transition to capitalism. So what it actually addressing at the time or at the turn of the 20th century is how countries are transformed from agricultural society into industrial society. I think people should be aware that industrial society is a very recent phenomena. It had only been with us 200 years plus. 1776 in England, you know, people are still mainly agriculturalist. The first town, industrial towns like Liverpool and Manchester, only began to develop in the latter part of the 18th century. So industrial society is a fairly recent phenomenon. And even in the United States, industrial did not begin seriously until after the Civil World War, after 1860. So, you know, it's just natural that this type of question would have been asked at the turn of the century concerning other parts of the European countries, Eastern European countries, and other European countries besides the UK. Okay, so the role of agriculture in building up industrial development like cheap food and raw materials and cheap labor loomed large in the discussion on the agrarian question. In Kowski's words, and I copied it for clarification, he wrote, we should ask, is capital, and in what ways is capital taking hold of agriculture, revolutionizing it, smashing the old forms of production and poverty and establishing the new forms which must succeed. So actually he was laying the emphasis on the force of capitalism in destruction of the old social forms, rural sector included. But he didn't look at it very negatively only because he mentioned the smashing up of poverty as well. So in a certain sense, you know, it's kind of like making a new scenario that perhaps poverty in the rural area can be gotten rid of. Agricultural production has already been transformed into industrial production. Economic life, even in the open countryside, once trapped in eternally rigid routines, is now caught up in the constant revolution, which is the hallmark of the capitalist mode of production. So capitalism really had the power, revolutionizing power, to change the sort of feudal, so-called scenario. Sorry. One of the key outcomes of capitalist transition in the countryside is de-peasantization, and the transformation of social classes under the influence of capitalist transition is a central component of the transition itself. So this is two points here, de-peasantization and the transformation of social classes. So once you have de-peasantization, what do these people become? Do they become lower class, living in the slum area, like Ajahnanan mentioned, selling their labor, or do they become middle class? So class questions are also, at the point of discussion here. Thus, the agrarian question is both an economic and a political question, and this is his terminology, that you cannot only look at it as economic scenario, but it's also a political concern. To go back to another scholars, contemporary scholar Bais, he worked in SOAS, School of Oriental and African Studies, Marxist, and he wrote something on capitalism from above and capitalism from below. Bais went back to the discussion of Lenin, who was an other Marxist figure beside Kautsky at the turn of the century. As a matter of fact, Lenin wrote a book on rise of capitalism in Russia, and it was first published in 1905. So it was, the same kind of like literature that these two classical Marxists were addressing at the end of the turn of the century. He discussed the 19th century Prussia, where feudal landlords initiated agricultural capitalist production. So it's the landlord who became, who turned into capitalist. It was them who did the fencing and then who produced large-scale agricultural produce and sell in the market. So the tenants became the workers under the landlord. That was the situation in Prussia. Landlords, where landlords became capitalist class and tenants became wage labor. In contrast with the model from the USA, United States, which could be described as capitalism from below, and that was when family farms, private entrepreneurs involved in commodification of production. So there's no landlord, there are farm family operators who utilize in innovation of technology, employing mechanization, so on and so forth, and engage themselves in production for capitalist markets, using high labor, of course, but it's another sort of models of transformation into industrial society. But then Bais suggested that we can catch a glimpse of capitalism from above, even in the USA, because contrasted with the southern, with the northern period, and this capitalism from above took place in the south, where they were engaged in plantation system using slave labor. So if we think of the American southern plantation system in the 19th century, before Lincoln's Civil War, abolition of slavery. It was all these large cotton plantations using labor of slaves transported from the African. So that was kind of also capitalist production, you know, but engaged by large landowners. So to sum up, Rick mentioned that one cannot think of one path of transformation to agriculture, to industrial society, but there are many parts to capitalist development in agriculture that drove it out of agriculture towards industrial society. So there's no single model. Each is a unique place, each have a unique characteristics, and of course historical underpinning. So if we took off the, did I skip a slide? There's another theorist by the name of Bernstein. Bernstein, which also influenced a lot of writing that Rick undertook in this book, suggested that when we entered into the 20th century, countries undergoing agrarian transition today are functioning in a very different global context from the discussion Kautsky or Lenin would have discussed in the beginning of the 20th century. The possibilities of foreign investment are such that industrialization can occur independent of an agrarian transition. Ajahn Anand mentioned this already. I listened to him early this morning when he said that you cannot only just focus on the role of the state or the confrontation of peasants with the state. For this present time, agrarian transformation, but the role of transnational cooperation is also very important. The social scenario had been different from the time when Kautsky and Lenin had did their discussion. So if you look at some non-Western models, you can see that Japan took a different route from either the Prussian model or the United States model. In Japan, there had been this Meiji land reform, partially successfully because the Meiji dynasty did get rid of the samurai class, and that to a certain extent free some kind of persons and turned them into independent smallholders. But when Japan reached the Second World War in 1941 until it ended in 1945, more than 50% of the population in Japan were still engaged in agriculture. And the U.S. Government occupation realized that very well, and that was why they introduced land reform, because without land reform, you know, things could have, you know, taken place like it did in China, where peasants were sort of making demand on land ownership. Korea and Taiwan are also under U.S. Influence, and there are lots of programs, state-led reforms, land reforms, and cooperatives. And cooperatives are sort of a very sort of strong phenomenon. And may I suggest that these two programs, land reforms and cooperatives, are not very strong in Thailand compared to these non-Western models where state had led into kind of like agrarian reforms in Japan, Korea, and Taiwan. So Japan, Korea, and Taiwan, after the Second World War, had turned into industrial societies with a lot of support from the U.S. government. I think people already knew about GSP, general special privilege, when the U.S. government exempted or reduced some of tax exports of industrial products of these countries into the U.S. market. So these countries had been able to export, you know, relatively cheap commodities into the U.S. because they did not have to compete with the high taxations as other countries would have. So that was another kind of like, you know, factors that resulted in a very great reduction in number of farmers in Japan, Korea, and Taiwan in the 70s and 80s. So now all three countries had less than 20% of the population engaged in agriculture, whereas directly after the Second World War, you know, it's kind of like 50% of the population in agriculture. Okay. So let's move to developing countries. Developing countries like other Southeast Asian countries and Thailand included entered into the 1980s under serious agro-industrial development program. And this involved subcontraction production. Janan already mentioned this earlier in the morning. So on the one hand, you have large agribusiness. And then on the other hand, you have small owner-operators or small farmers. And small farmers produce according to what agribusiness dictated and then sell back their produce to the agribusiness markets. So you did not have to have a kind of like enclosure like the Prussian model. You don't have to have, you know, the sort of the large plantations like the American model. You don't have to have a kind of like heavy utilization of tractors like the U.S. Northern Farmers Development, or you don't have the Japan, Korean, or Taiwanese models of state-led development, but you have this phenomenon of subcontraction after a grow industry. And I think people already know CP of Thailand. Jeroen Phokkapan is a very large agribusiness in Thailand. CP began its operation by selling vegetable seeds to farmers, but after that, their activities expanded, including production of poultry, hogs. So they contain control, I think, more than one third of the poultry market, and also pork meat that you bought from a supermarket. There are a few others relatively smaller agricultural companies like the Saha Farm, which, you know, had relatively much less market share than CP, and there's another one, Beta Grow, which is also relatively very small. So CP control one third of the market get share of meat industry. Ajahn Anand mentioned corn production in Thailand, which are now invading into the highland area. Agriculture is also expanding. Okay, corn can be utilized into gasohol production, but we still very relatively, you know, sort of young into that experiment. Leave that to the U.S. Chemical industry. But people can guess that these large amount of corn production had been transported into feeding the poultry and hog industry under CP management, not to mention other kinds of agricultural products. Rick mentioned in his book, chapter 2, on the conceptual framework of structure and agency. He didn't do it very well, but I think what he wanted to touch there is the macro versus the micro studies in agrarian transition. So on the one hand, you can have people like Kautsky, Lenin, Bais, whoever, who talk about a macro change scenario and so on and so forth. But what about the change of life of the rural people? And anthropologists are very good at that. Sometimes at the expense of the macro structure, whereas political economists focused on the macro structure with the ignorance on the life of the rural people. So what he was trying to introduced here under his subtitle Structure and Agency is how we combine the two views, the macro views and the micro views, into framing out perceptual understanding of the rural change. So if we look back into rural life in the West, it has changed now dramatically. You have less than 20 people engaged in agriculture, but the rural sector, the rural atmosphere is still there. So you have new people who are not farmers who move into enjoy the rural serenity. And I heard that even some Western European people now try to buy land in Eastern European countries to build their country home in Eastern Europe because it's so much cheaper, you know, and you can sort of, you know, have a really relatively sort of, you know, sort of rural, inverted comma, life, and then you can still be in touch with the modern world because now you can use electronic media, so on and so forth. So rural life in the West had changed its meaning. Also, there are other more sort of mundane activities like urban and industrial activities invading into the rural space, reducing the rural space somewhat, but not really that much for some I think rurality, you know, had kind of like been preserved, you know, for its kind of like how can you say, aesthetics value, you know, kind of like the purity of the air, you know, and that comes with a change in industrial society because people are so much, you know, sort of hold together into, you know, sort of very tight rural space. So rural space gain, you know, kind of like aesthetic meaning. But its place of agricultural production, of course, is still very important, you know, as long as people still have to eat, and especially, you know, if they still want to eat fresh food. But the landscape has changed, especially in the West. So now you are having kind of like rural towns, towns which are small, which are nice, which have basic conveniences, you know, sort of small stores. And I'm thinking of Australian rural towns, you know, that could have been the example, all the sufficiency, you know, rural. But, you know, one may wonder, you know, it's different from rural in developing countries. Okay, so now we come to an article by someone whom Rick mentioned and who had become very important in a lot of people in modern rural studies in Thailand, and that is Hoggart. I think you can search for his article in Rick's bibliography. He dismissed the concept of the rural altogether. So what's the point of studying rural study? There's no more rural study to be studied. It's also like, you know, in 1985, you know, it was the date of Marxism, who now studied Marxism, and so on and so forth. And it's the same kind, you know, of like atmosphere, who now study rural. And he gave two reasons for the dismissal of the concept of rurality. The first is that the evidence of diversity in the rural areas make it difficult to treat them as a category. So now you have rural areas which are very urban. And if people look around Chiang Mai, you'd find that Chiang Mai, if you travel 30 kilometers out of the town center of Chiang Mai, you find that it's rural, but it's not rural in a sense that you have laundry shop, you have internet capacity, you have Tesco Lotus, you have electricity. You look at the houses are very modern. They all have refrigerators, mobile phones, so on and so forth, lots of cars. So you know, it's not anymore rural in the sense of a kind of like a dichotomy to the urban space, because certain things are quite similar. And second, the processes which underpin change in the rural areas are not distinctive from those that was present in the urban area, in a sense that you receive certain kind of social welfare, you watch the same television news, you listen to the same radio programs, perhaps you change to different channels. You read the same newspaper, so it's kind of like, you know, dictate of urban life and rural life are the same. So why bother making a differentiation between rural and urban space and rural and urban life? So what is rural life in Thailand? Are we already entering into the phase of urbanized rural life? Some people did ask Ajahn Anand a question this morning about the connectivity between urban space and rural space. You know, you've got so much changes. So, you know, let's dismiss the rural concept, you know, and talk about urbanized rural life, you know, just similarity of lifestyle, but, you know, just only different space. Are rural people in Thailand already middle class? And that was the question that was phrased by Walker's book, Thailand's Political Peasant, came out in 2012, 3 years ago, when he discussed this one village in Smeung province. And he said that the income of the farmers that he studied over the average income of the whole population. So, you know, people are already middle class. So this kind of argument, the Hoggard argument and the Walker argument, could fit very well together. But before we accept that, and that's why I put a question mark there, let's look at some other thing first, like rural industry. Rick mentioned rural industry in Thailand, which especially quite a lot in the northeast, when you have these what Marxists would call the putting out systems, when you have people bringing the farmers' materials and then farmers produce according to demand. But there are also industrial settlement, like the industrial settlement near the Lamphun area, near Chiang Mai, where people commute to work every day from their rural homes in the village, 40 kilometers to work in the industrial settlement, and then coming back to sleep in the village, or find employment in town centers like in Chiang Mai that Ajahn Anand mentioned. Or you can have workshops in the rural area, building small factories in the rural area, when you can employ something like 50 to 200 people. For example, in San Patong district, 30, 40 kilometers from the center of Chiang Mai, you have these dried long gan factories. When you dry long gan fruits and pack them in plastic bags, you know, and then sort of export them to places. So, you know, workshops like these, you know, are quite a few in the rural area. Or you can have piece work, having people in the rural area hired to do a certain kind of job, like sewing. Sewing is the most popular piece job. It can be crafting, like wood carving, are also quite popular. There can even be some fake gemstones, polishing, you know, for workers in the northeastern, when they make kind of like fake jewelries, you know, using labor of the local the rural population. For some rural household, having access to rural based non-farm work enables them to remain in the countryside. And that was from page 133. I did not write that. It was Rick who wrote that. So what he was saying there, and I agreed, is that you don't earn enough from agriculture. I was engaged in recent research in rural change in Thailand. I apologize, I did not write in English, so I couldn't distribute a copy. But cost of production are so much over 50%, which means that cost of production of rice are so much higher than the price that peasants can sell. That was before Khun Ying Lak 15,000 baht price guarantee. But people still produce that because they wanted to have something to eat, some kind of like security. But if you think in terms of monetary terms, it's not enough to earn cash from agricultural production. So non-farm work enables people to survive. Also, temporary urban jobs from member of the family, remittance that were sent from children who work in the urban center contributed a lot to farm families. People, farm families would not survive alone on farming, but they rely on non-farm employment and remittances from some young members of the family. If you look at 1996 class figures, that was from Rick's page 135, but it was not his figure. It was from another person, Khun, I think it was Khun Chai Ung Pha Korn, who produced this from statistical national statistic figure. So in 1996, there were 31.5 million population adult working population, and you can divide that as 2.2% new middle class, 13.5% as petty traders and family workers, 43% farmers or peasants, and then 41% workers. But after having shown you these figures, I'd ask you to be cautious of Thai government statistical figures, because I did one recently in my research, and I find that can be contradictory. For example, Department of Statistics, National Census, will produce a set of figure, whereas Department of Agricultural Census, which belongs to a different ministry, can produce another set of figure. So make sure you do compare them very well when you do utilize government figures. Okay, 1996. So let's move to a more kind of like up-to-date figure. This is from my own research. I calculated that from, you know, Census Bureau figure and Ministry of Agriculture figure, and come up with some kind of like, you know, possible conclusion. Number of farms are 5.9 million, so nearly 6 million are still engaged in farming in Thailand. Members per farm family is 388, varying from region to region. This gave a total sum of 22.89 million farm population. Total population in Thailand is around 65 million, let's say 66 for simplicity sake. So you have one third of the population engaged in farming in Thailand in the year 2012, which was 3 years ago. And according to this number, slightly over 6 million still lived below poverty line of 15,000 baht per month per household. So that means that you have to divide 15,000 baht by 3.88 to get a per head or per capita income of a poor household. And most people live in the northeast and the northern part of Thailand. And this is government figure. It's a little bit complicated when the Census Bureau and the Ministry of Agriculture presented their figure, but they would agree that it's, you know, 6 million below poverty line. I tend to be pessimistic, so I sort of highlighted 6 million under poverty line. But if you are optimistic, like Walker is, you can say that how many? 14 million, right? 22 minus 6, you get something like 16 millions above poverty line. So in a sense, you know, Walker is correct in a sense that you have now middle class, you know, rural people, 16 million people, you know, having income higher than the poverty line. But if you look at the other side of the same coin, then you have 6 million people who are still below poverty line. So 15,000 divided by 4, you have something like 3,000 baht, a little bit, you know, a month, which is not a lot if you have to buy, you know, food. And poor people, mind you, did not own land. They have to rent land. So, you know, this 15,000 baht would have to, you know, be deduced for paying for land rents as well. So 3,000 baht a month is really not that sufficient. Okay, so I let the figure speak for itself. A virtuous cycle of farm, non-farm, and rural-urban relations. I shouldn't take longer than 10 minutes. This is a kind of like a mockery of, what's his name, Gunnar Model's vicious cycle, 1960s theory about how, you know, you have kind of like poverty and then you cannot get out of the poverty trap. So Rick termed it a virtuous cycle of farm, non-farm, and rural-urban relations. And he quoted a study by a person called Bray in 1986 of rice economies in Asia. And I agree with Bray's. Intensive rice farming dovetails very neatly with petty commodity production, which requires very little capital to set up a family enterprise and absorb surplus labor without depriving the farm workers at times of peak demand. It can be expanded, diversified, or contracted to meet market demands, but the combination with the rice farm guarantees families subsistence. Actually, I think, you know, you can note that this had been more than 30 years old. But I still agree with the last sentence. Rice farm guarantees the family subsistence. So people still farm for rice, even though they don't sell at very high price because it guarantees their subsistence. It's a kind of like safety net that you produce your own food. So people still have this mentality of trying to lean on to something, you know, that they can fall all. And if you ask why, because employment in industrial sector are not very stable. There's no guarantee that tomorrow you will still be employed. And if you are not employed, what about benefits that you will get? Despite the fact that we now have social welfare program, it's still really not that very sufficient. So people still need to find their own revenue of security to fall back upon. So that's why people, at least some of the people, still remain in the farming sectors. And that's why people, young people who move out to find employment in the industrial sector still remit, send back money into farm families because they still want to tie this connection. They don't know when they're going to be out of work. So certain relationships with the farm folks have still to be maintained. So, yeah, like I said before, even though Bray's study was 30 years old, I agreed with the last sentence. Certain details may have been changed. Rural economy and rural sector, in my opinion, still different from the urban economy, despite the fact that rural sector has become more urbanized in their lifestyle. So I disagree with Hoggart. I'm going to disagree with Walker later, but first let me disagree with Hoggart first, that I think we cannot really dismiss the concept of the rural, because rurality still have this special meaning of providing a security to the uncertain industrial world where, you know, people would not have control. Despite the fact that, you know, you have more kind of like urbanized life in present day rural sector. Okay, Then Rick moved on to a section on farmers in the city, and this was about this person, which is also 50 years old article, who suggested that farmers in Indonesia may have been spatially displaced to the urban center, but their social and cultural identity remain rooted in the countryside. Can this depiction still applicable to today's rural life? Okay, that was old work, but there was a more recent work, not just my view, but the other person called De Gregorio's study in Hanoi in 1994, and his or her study was entitled Urban Harvest, Recycling as a Peasant Industry in Northern Vietnam. She talked about rural people in Vietnam who moved to Hanoi to collect garbage to be recycled, sell that, you know, and make money. And they still want to maintain close ties with the rural town because they still want to fall back into the rural place in case of, you know, sort of uncertainty in the garbage collection, even though it's not a very lucrious kind of like occupations. So, you know, I cited this as a kind of like a supportive view, you know, of another person beside me or Bruno or Brace, whoever. Metropolitan villagers, Kais in 2010 described farmers in the northeast of Thailand as metropolitan villagers. It's he presented first time in RCSD Agrarian Transformation Seminar. I think you can get hold of Kai's paper, which is very interesting. That farmers had traveled extensively both within the country and abroad. That their political and social outlook had been more like middle class people in the metropolitan area. This came out 2 years before Walker's Thailand's political peasant, where Walker also, you know, accept similar point of view, even though he didn't use the terminology metropolitan villagers like Kais did, but the tone, you know, was on middle class people. And okay. Yeah, and people, of course, 2012 middle class villagers was the terminology that he used. People have become more middle class in their income, and therefore they have become independent in their voting behavior, like middle class in town who voted independently. So there was a slight jump here when you said that people in the rural area are middle class, full stop. And then you have another sentence, people in town are middle class, full stop. And though you have this connection that say that, so they vote independently, but there's no logical connection why they have to do that, except for, you know, the cementing, you know, of the two behaviors by the word middle class, but there's no other explanation. And, you know, whether it was middle class, okay, he may be correct because 22 minus 6, which is 16, right? Whatnot, millions, perhaps can be called middle class in the sense that they are above poverty line. But actually, I did some calculations and I find that around Thailand, how can you say, median is 23 baht per month per family, and only 1/3 of Thai population earn more than 23 baht per month per family. So actually the gap between 15 and 23, you know, are still filled with a lot of people. So even though people are above poverty line, of 15,000 baht per month, they still did not reach the 23,000 baht per month of the average income. So the gap is very high, not only between urban and rural, even between rural dwellers themselves, the gap are very high. So you can have rich people living in the rural area enjoy the comfort of electric media, television, so on and so forth. And at the back of their house, you can still have small huts filled with elderly people who couldn't find employment, so it's a kind of like what I call the invisible poverty that are pocketed in all wealthy rural rich inverted comma town. So come back to the earlier slide, rural life in Thailand. Are we already entering into the phase of urbanized rural life? Are rural people in Thailand already middle class, as Walker suggested? So the answer is yes and no, as I already said, because you on the one hand have people who really had become better, but on the other hand, there's still a lot of people who live under poverty. If one follows Hoggard's argument that there is no longer any distinction between rural and urban life, let's dismiss the conceptual frame of rurality, one would opt to say yes, like Walker did. No rurality now. People have hot water, refrigerator, television, and so on and so forth. So we middle class. So let's dismiss this rurality. But if you think that the rural sector still maintains unique structure, one would be slightly hesitant to say yes. And as I think that it still, you know, have a unique structure, I would be hesitant to say yes. There are still 6 million people living below poverty line. Patron client are still important structure in rural sector, both in economic relations as well as political relations. Especially if you are a poor people, you have to rely on other people to either get economic assistance or political support. The role of economic brokerage in subcontraction production is very crucial. And as political brokerage or vote boss to a certain sector of the population. So let's not throw the baby with the bath water, because, you know, there still matters to a certain sector of the population. And that's in the presentation. And now I give people opportunity to show their voice and engage in a discussion of agreement, disagreement, queries, and so on and so forth. So the floor is open. Thank you.
So, good morning. I would like to ask Ajahn Jamari about the counter urbanization. It's like nowadays many rich people move into the rural, but they are not they just want to consume the scenery but not produce any kind of production. So what happened with the concept of rurality if they just go and buy the land? And some people that are poor, they just want to sell the land. So what will happen in the next future? Thank you.
Yeah, I wouldn't say no to that. I mean, if I have a piece of land, I am poor and I need money, I also would sell. It's very logical, very rational way to do things. But let me answer this by not answering it. In a sense that now we produce 30 million tons of rice, which is more than sufficient for domestic consumption. Domestic consumption was something like around 10 million, roughly. It can fluctuate a little bit. Farmers would keep about 3 to 4 to 5 million for their consumption. And then people like you and me, who are urban dwellers who don't grow rice, buy from domestic market. So that was something around 10 million tons. So we still have surplus of rice, 20 million tons that we are export. So we still can afford, you know, to sort of lose some agricultural land if it is that, you know, sort of simple mathematical calculations. And I wouldn't be romantic about rural life in a sense that rural life is a very hard life. You have to wake up early in the morning for 5 o'clock, if not before, in order to go to tend your field. And then, you know, right through the day, it's hot. You're sweating, working in the fields. So let's not be romantic about that, you know. Even though people are still using more tractors, machinery and so on and so forth, rural life is still a hard life. If you look at farmers, very sort of darkened skin, you know, sort of aging prematurely because of the hard work that they do. So let's not be romantic about it, trying to preserve the rural life and the rurality. Yes.
Thank you for a really interesting, I'm not a agrarian specialist by any means, so it's really fascinating kind of historical and theoretical overview, which I found really useful. I had a sort of a question about how useful some of these categories that we're using are. So this rural-urban dichotomy and, for instance, this sort of peasant-middle-class dichotomy, and I suppose what's going on, you know, in terms of the dynamism between these categories, and where do we need to, you know, whether it's a productive conversation to say, oh, well, we have to prove that rural areas are remaining rural, or, you know, urban areas are remaining urban. And one of the things that certainly came to my mind was just sort of the role of peri-urban areas as a concept in some of my reading about sort of urban planning and regional development, and what role this notion of areas that are on the fringe of major cities but retain sort of rural characteristics in terms of producing, you know, basic agricultural commodities that are, you know, key for the operation of major cities, but also retaining a sizable, you know, rural, you know, peri-urban workforce that may migrate on a daily basis even into the city, but still retain some sort of, you know, basic subsistence. What role does that play in this discussion about kind of rural-urban dynamics?
Yeah, I don't know whether I'd be capable to answer your question, but it's something that I've been thinking for a couple of years myself, and these thoughts somehow led me to think about so-called sociology of knowledge, or how knowledge produced, in a sense that I don't know. I think empirical data is really very important, in a sense that you really need to sort of have your eyes open and, you know, try to see, you know, as much as you can and collect as many information as you can from various sources and then weigh them yourselves. But on the other hand, theories are also very important in the sense that it directs our vision to a certain, so you know, you life is very short, so you really can't have time to sort of look around and try to gather as much information as, you know, as you need in order to understand the world or in order to understand a social phenomena. So sometimes a theory is very helpful, you know, it's kind like of framing or shaping the direction of data that you like to collect. But the problem is of theory, or sometimes, you know, that people call conceptual framework, is that it entrapped our way of thinking in a sense that you don't think beyond that frame, or you don't think beyond that terminologies. You tend to, you know, try to find things to either prove or disprove the concept, which can be dangerous. I sort of find that, you know, when I write research proposals, you know, there would be this section. I like the literature reviews. I think the literature reviews, you know, that are required of you when you write a proposal is very useful because it allows you to sort of explore what other people have written. But when it comes to the conceptual framework section, I really don't like it. But I sometimes, you know, sort of manage to put up one. And in the end, you know, sort of dismissed it, you know, because it contrary to what I sort of found out. But having said that, this rural-urban dichotomy, there's a history to that, actually. There has been this Thai scholar, Anek Lau Thammathat. Some of you may already have heard of his name. He wrote in Thai, but shouldn't be difficult to sort of find summary of his writing, English, about... it's called Song Nakara Prachathipatai, or A Tale of Two Cities, or a city, a rural city, and an urban city, a rural lower class city, and an urban middle class city. And actually, I think Anek, even though he didn't mention it in his references, got his idea from this study in Africa about how, you know, in the rural area, people voted according to their clanship. So, you know, voters are not independent, but they are the head of the clan who sort of dictated who the rural population should vote. As, you know, vis-a-vis urban population who are more westernized, who are more middle class, who got, you know, sort of western education, who voted independently like the western people voted because they got this western education, so they think about policies and so on and so forth. So there was these two models, you know, rural people don't think, and sometimes people may accuse them of being stupid, you know, harsh words can be directed at the population, whereas urban are more liberated and so on and so forth. So Nick wrote this book. He was very sympathetic with the farmers, the peasant sector, mind you, and he was making argument for them that the reason that they voted according to dictation of the vote boss or whoever, you know, who sort of happened to be influential people in the rural sector or the patrons in the rural sectors are because they cannot hope for help from government schemes. There had not in the past been, you know, much government schemes that are directly directed to poor people in the rural area. So whoever or whatever patrons, you know, who sort of introduced programs or helps in whatever forms into the rural sector would receive the vote, would receive the respects, because these are people who brought into their lives some of the things. So it was this, what you call, debate that he put on. So then you have later generation, especially after the Thai Rak Thai and the Pua Thai people came into power in Thailand. And I think people are already aware that, you know, there was this fierce debate about, you know, middle class people, educated class people in Thao who did not vote Pua Thai or Thai Rak Thai, accusing the rural population as being stupid, you know, or voted for, you know, sort of popular gain or economic gain, votes are bought and so on and so forth. So there was this idea, you know, that there was this dichotomy in the urban and rural sector. And to a certain extent, that was true. There were some urban people who looked down on the rural people and say that they're stupid. And they, you know, just thought hope for a short term gain. But the problem is that once you want to, how can you say, stand for or support the rural population, you know, and give excuse for them that they're not being stupid, then you go over the extremities to the other side without looking at the fact, you know, just for argument's sake. And that's why I think sociology of knowledge is very important, because you're entrapped into engaging in argument that peasants are not stupid. They cannot be stupid. They're human beings like us. So, you know, they behave very rationally and so on and so forth. So that was correct in the sense of arguments, you know, because you have to stand for the poor. That's what we have been taught or brought up to in social science, to stand beside the poor. But don't let's get entrapped into argument by argument's sake, you know, just overthrow one side of argument without looking at the empirical fact. I'm not quite sure whether I answer your question, but that's what I've been thinking in the past couple of years.
I want to ask something about urban life and ruler. I want to know about your opinion about, I think that they have the priority shift about something, being about ruler and being a urban life. I just want to know why, how then, and why you think about that humans or ruler people think about the urban social. I want to know how they can move about their perform farming or something like agriculture like that. Are they have a in the future? Are they have a new thinking about that, or they have passed and then they don't grow up about it?
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah. Like I answered Kun Arati before, that I'm not romantic about preserving the rural sector. You know, agrarian question is the transformation of agricultural sector, agricultural society into industrial society. So I was hoping for that too. I was hoping for urbanized way of life for everyone too. And in Thailand, that took place. And if you look into the detailed statistics of head of farming household, the 5.9 million farm household in Thailand at the moment, majority of them, more than 80%, are aged 50 years old or over. So you have relatively very young people as head of farming household, because young people all migrated out of town. So, you know, if you think in simple mathematics, arithmetics, you can say that this, you know, problem can be solved because, you know, in 20 years' time, you would have farming population aging 70, you know, and out of farming because new generations wouldn't want to be engaged into the farm. You know, they're sort of, you know, now in of the 3.88 farm families, you know, you have the husband and wife, that makes only two. So the 1.88, you know, are kind of like young people who are eager, waiting to go out of the farming sector. Or you can have, you know, sort of people in their 40s who perhaps, you know, hadn't been very successful in industrial factory service life, you know, sort of return home. So that was a very sort of small portion. So eyes are looking towards the urban industrial sector. And that was where, you know, the pay are so much better and so on and so forth. Those are remain now, you know, could remain because of subcontraction agribusiness. So even though I sort of, you know, tend to sort of had kind of like perhaps a negative, you know, sort of outlook in my mentioning of CP and Beta Grow and people like that, they've been doing some benefits, you know, in the sense that they are people who sort of provided income to the rural sector to a certain extent. Okay, so eyes, you know, are in the urbanized sectors. So that's the micro level. But if you think of the macro level, if we run out of people who are engaged in agriculture, what would become of Thailand's food sufficiency program? Do we still have people who are, you know, food producers remaining within the country? And as I said, you know, 10 million are enough. We now sort of two-thirds, you know, overproduction in rice. So I wouldn't worry too much about that. But there have been this phenomenon about this regional involvement. And this took place, I think, 27 years ago, when we had Prime Minister Chat Chai Chunhawan as Prime Minister 27 years ago, whose well-known motto is to change the battlefield into commercial field. And after that, we have this regional cooperation and so on and so forth. So now we can see that I'm not quite sure whether this is the correct word or not, agricultural cooperation. I would put cooperation in heavy quotations in the sense that I'm not quite sure whether it's cooperation or not. But eyes of planners in Thailand are turned into countries, smaller countries like Laos, as a kind of like, you know, land abandoned agricultural producers to feed the Thai market, or Myanmar, you know, as a kind of like abandoned land, you know, to still sort of supply this regional food stuff. So let's be aware of this, you know, kind of like regional cooperation. People are still very enthusiastic about that. And now kids, you know, have to sort of study English at school, you know, in order to engage in regional cooperation. But food also would be transferred, you know, so kind of like across countries. So you would have Thai agribusiness producing in Myanmar, in Laos, or, you know, even poultry industry in Indonesia. Okay, you can have laborers, you know, sort of moving cross countries. So in Thailand now, in agricultural sector, it's labor scarce, despite the fact of 22 million people are still in agriculture. But we employed over a million from Myanmar in agriculture. People know about labor from Myanmar, but quite a large percentage of labor from Myanmar work in agriculture, not to mention Lao. Ajahn Soimat in the other room did research on Lao workers, you know, who work in agriculture in Thailand. So it's kind of like a very complicated situation, and this regional cooperation perhaps will free some Thai farmers, you know, out of the farming sector, but not to their riches, perhaps, you know. It's kind of like much more complicated to that. But farmers would be pleased enough, because, you know, then they can have enjoyed the urban way of life. Yes, gentleman in the orange raised the hand first, and the lady can go first. Sorry.
Okay, so a very short question. I saw quite a number of urban middle class people move to do some kind of organic farming in the northern part of Thailand, or also central part of Thailand. Do they have some kind of mingle between like this kind of urban people who move and do some kind of farming to the local people? Is there any kind of influence towards each other in this case?
Yes, there were quite a few, especially in hydroponic, because hydroponic is a high valued market. So you need a lot of investment, you know, in sort of chemical fertilizers. You have to set up a good, you know, sort of greenhouse systems in order to produce hydroponic. So I'm not quite sure about that. It's not my field, but I heard quite a number. And actually in San Kampang, I think they took you to Mae Kampong on the way between Chiang Mai Town and Mae Kampong. There was this very sort of medium-sized farm, you know, that produce hydroponic, and they'd been exporting it into, they supplied, you know, restaurants in Chiang Mai, but they also exported to Bangkok and also to Singapore by train, you know, so it's kind of like you have middle-class people now engaged in agricultural activities in a kind of like capitalist systems. This could take place more in the future, though I still doubt whether it would be a kind of like a large number as far as independent entrepreneurs are concerned. I would have thought it would have been more under the hand of large agribusiness, would have kind of like more, you know, logistic system delivery of products, agricultural produce, and managing the order. It's going to be more kind of like industrial agriculture in the future. Yes, a gentleman in orange. been raising his hand for some time.
Okay, thank you for the opportunity that was given to me. I wanna asking about the life of rural people at current village. Yesterday, some of my friends go to the village, and then they bring the honey over there, and then they tell about the quality of the honey, the good quality. So my question is, how the villager or how the rural people there to maintain the honey, because I ask you the question because I hear the I got the some information that the Thailand government just now want to give the budget for the village for the villager over there about if I'm not mistaken about 1,000 million in baht, but they don't want to take it because I don't know what is the reason. So my next question is how they maintain the honey without budget?
How do they maintain
I mean how the villager, how the rural people are there to maintain the honey industry without budget?
Sorry, I couldn't catch that. How do you spell that? The honey?
Yes.
How do you spell that? Sorry. Oh, the honey. Okay. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, got it.
Okay. You got it, my question?
Yeah, if you're talking about the honey.
Yeah, how because just now I hear information that the Thailand government give the villager a budget about 1,000 million in baht, but they don't want to take it the budget. So I refuse. I mean I confuse how they maintain, how they develop the honey industry there without budget, because we know that the quality the honey from there is good quality, because I have tasted.
Which village is that?
Yes.
Which village is that?
Karen village. Chiang Rai, in Chiang Rai. I don't know the saying in Thai language.
Yeah, and that's relatively new for me. I haven't heard of this honey producing village before, so it was relatively new for me too. But so I was surprised why, you know, the villagers wouldn't accept the government assistance. But as far as I know, you know, there had been, you know, other kinds of assistance, like for example, during the Thaksin government, there has been this Health for All program where villagers can register and get their card, health card, you know, in order to get free medication from the hospital. Or there had been this 1 million baht per village program, where each village would be given 1 million baht deposited in a government saving bank, so they can sort of, you know, all transactions would have to be made with a government saving bank. That is, you have to withdraw money and then, you know, sort of give to people who want to get grants from the village funds. But once you get grants from the village funds, you're supposed to deposit it back into government saving bank. So that was a kind of a good precaution as far as economic precaution was concerned. And there had been other, you know, sort of government assistance program, like the cattle programs where government would distribute free cattle for villagers to raise, and then you know return the cattle later once you know after the cattle had produced their calves. Or there had been kind of like assistant in rubber plantation programs where they sell rubber seedlings to farmers at relatively cheap price, 20 baht per seedling or something like that. So there had been kind of like a lot of government funds, you know, giving to our villagers, not to mention, you know, the last program on rice buying program and so on and so forth. And even this new military government, you know, distributed 1,000 baht per rice, per farmer, per rice growers, but you have to register, you know, that you're really rice growers, having the village headman to countersign, you know, acknowledge that you're really a rice grower, and then, you know, sort of receiving a 1,000 baht per rice, you know, as a subsidy from the government. So that was a surprise in a sense that why, you know, they didn't accept the grants, you know, relative new to me that villagers don't accept grants.
My point of my question is how they improvement the industry of honey there without budget, because I know that the honey there export to the Japan too, also export really? To the Japan. So how they improve the honey there without the
budget.
Without budget from
yes.
from the government?
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you.
You mean they had more kind of like strong community
yes.
and stuff like that
yes.
without
yes.
accepting budget from the government? That's interesting. I mean, if you have, you know, kind of like community like this, you know, who can sort of do improvement without, you know, having to accept budgets from the government, we should sort of popularize this more, you know, as a kind of like a development model.
Just like would like to share with you, I talked to the village headman, and the reason that they deny the grant from the government is might be because if you could accept that kind of grant, it can create a conflict among the communities people, because like the level of the greedy is not equal to each other, and this kind of thing like to get approached, that's what he said, that to get into this kind of grant, you might have like to compete each other, and they don't want this kind of thing that happen into their community. So just like cut it right at the beginning. So that's the reason why they deny this kind of grant.
Also added to that, the Japanese government actually gave the community money to develop the honey. So that's how they got the money to develop the honey production. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Maybe yeah. how would you mark that, like when we talk about the rural agrarian culture, we can kind of trace back, right? But when we would like to study about urban agrarian, when to start, or what would be the appropriate period to mark the rural or the urban agricultural period of time? Do you understand?
No.
I mean, like, so normally when you study rural agrarian sector, right, you can sort of trace back, like, how, I mean, whatever the period of time is, but when, if I would like to study the rural or modern agricultural sector, when would be the time that to mark the period of time that this is like the beginning of the urban agriculture or modern agriculture?
Yes, I think for Thailand or even for Southeast Asian countries in general, the rise of agribusiness perhaps would mark, you know, sort of very interesting turning point in agricultural production in the country, because it's going to sort of change, you know, sort of shape of agricultural sector, and also sort of social relations. And it's a very good policy on, you can look at policy level as well, because by taking this path of industrial development, you don't need land reform. As I mentioned earlier, we don't have land reform, we don't have cooperatives, but we have this agribusiness, you know, who sort of manage, you know, the production without having to go into confrontation with farmers, without having to buy off their land. So you avoid political confrontation. You know, you can have your agricultural produce without having to buy anyone off. So it's kind of like these, you know, sort of arrangements are very interesting. But mind you, and some of people I know are studying this, is that it didn't have, so there's still plenty of room to sort of do agribusiness research. Because agribusiness did not operate on a kind of like modern, how can we say, office system, you know, kind of like no emotion kind of like type, you know, sort of transaction. But actually they've been utilizing a lot of traditional social relations, like agribusiness would contact a village headman, or would contact, you know, someone who is very famous in the rural area, and then, you know, sort of ask them to organize, you know, the supplies or producers, you know, under their management. But if you think that it is modern, if you think of Amway, I'm not quite sure whether you can call Amway a kind of like modern organization or not, but in Amway line of production or line of sales management, you have the diamond, you have the golden, you have the emerald, whatnot, who kind of like, you know, kind of like controller of the hub, you know, of lesser kind of like sellers, you know, below them. So in agricultural system, it's the same pattern, because the company do not sign contract with individual farmers. That would be too much, you know, paper and too much kind of like burden for them. So they hire someone on a casual basis, you know, to sort of contact the farmers. So this is kind of like very interesting technology. Yes?
You mentioned this this text that you that was looking at sort of the tale of a urban city and a rural city, and that the sort of the conclusions that came from that about urban dwellers being less reliant on, more reliant on government, and therefore more perhaps autonomous. You know, this conclusion about urban dwellers being more individualistic and rural dwellers being more more communal and therefore more vulnerable to sort of patronage and clientelism. You sort of presented it, but didn't sort of give your own sort of conclusion or position. Do you think that this characterization holds in terms of, I mean, I think it's interesting in terms of the conclusion about urban dwellers being more individualistic because they're more reliant on government services, which doesn't necessarily hold from some of the comparative literature about how government receipts or receipt of government services impacts your approach to, you know, it doesn't necessarily, from other contexts, result in people being more, you know, policy oriented necessarily. So I just wonder what your position is and whether you think that dichotomy is a useful one, or perhaps whether it needs to be broken down to particular sectors, and whether this idea of rural households that are producing for urban industries and perhaps have linkages to urban areas, there's a different sort of argument there about their political values and political, you know, leanings. But I just wanted to sort of get your thoughts on that.
Yeah. How could I say? It's I've been thinking about this, you know, as I said to you myself for a couple of years. I think it had kind of like the dichotomy had some kinds of like a landmark, you know, for for people to think around it, you know, whether it is true or not. I am to the opinion that, you know, for very poor people, 6 million people who are still below the poverty line, the patron-client relations are still very important for them, both economically and politically, because they have to sort of get assistance. You know, I mean, they need more assistance than most people. But of course, then you still have the 22 million minus 6, you know, who perhaps are in the rural area, who perhaps did not need that much assistance as the 6 million. So that's another category. But you cannot lump them together because these 26 minus 22 minus 6 are can still be divided and subdivided. For example, you can have people who are really sort of extremely sort of individualistic in the sense that, you know, they can sort of make their own judgment, independent judgment, and policy oriented and so on and so forth. But those other people who might be economically needy, you know, still have these kind of ties of friendships. Not necessarily hierarchical, could have been kind of like equal friendship, people who go to school together, people who, I don't know, who work together, people who drink together and so on and so forth, you know, who share the same kind of like political attitudes. And this is one very noticeable thing, because you don't chat with people who don't share your own religious values, and you don't chat with people who don't share your political values. So it's kind of like, you know, like-minded sort of group together. So you can have kind of like, you know, this kind of like a group feeding in, you know, with a kind of like influentials to people. So I wouldn't jump to conclusion that, you know, you can sort of say that the rural sector possessed one mentality as a group, a homogeneous rural sector possessing a homogeneous mentality or, you know, political point of view. And I'm not suggesting that you can have the poor rural dwellers and the richer dwellers possessing opposing political views, but I'm suggesting something that, you know, they're kind of like these social relations, which are kind of like influential. People don't look only just at policy, but people do look at policy, but they're also, you know, friends, opinion, you know, sort of relatives, opinion, parents, opinions, or even children's opinions. If you are an acceptor or receptor of remittance from your child, you know, young children in the urban sector. So this kind of like exchange of information not necessarily have to be on class based, you know, at work. And that was so also with the urban sector as well, because when you talk about independent judgment, how independent it is that? I mean, people don't just, you know, sort of grow ideas out of their head without no a priori sort of information, you know, and kind of stuff. So it's kind of like, you know, it people are different, but there are factors, you know, that kind of like produce this different. It's not because they live in the urban sector and they live in the rural sector that make them different, think differently. Or it's not because they are rich and they are poor, which make them think differently, though that may contribute to a certain aspects. But there are other factors like peers, like information, like, I don't know, you know, your previous experience with life or with things in general. So it's very complicated, and one shouldn't attempt to try to simplify things which are complicated, because it can be very dangerous. Oh, of course, but when we don't clarify things, you know, we are always in the mud because nothing gets clarified. So how do you tread, you know, between you know, these two aspects? Uh,
Okay. No more questions. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ajahn, for a very critical talk. Thank you.
I think I enjoyed this more than the audience, so thank the audience for being patient with me.